Back at work, after a nice
punch in the clock.
Yeah, after a bit of freedom. I'm Garrett McQueen.
I'm Scott Blankenship.
And this is Trilloquy, true and real stories from the fringes of classical music. We're fresh off of a little weekend excursion.
A nice long weekend.
To the North Shore. I had, you know, if 2 years ago, if you said I'm taking a trip to the North Shore, I'd have no idea what you're talking about. So I'm not going to assume that everyone listening knows what the North Shore is or where that is. Scott, what is the North Shore?
They're referring to the North Shore of Lake Superior, which runs a good portion of the eastern border of Minnesota.
And we were talking about going up there for a long time. You had all of these fond memories and talking about how beautiful it is up there.
It's magical. It has a mystic sort of feel to me.
It really does. And I'm handing this over to you because, you know, it was my first trip to the North Shore of Minnesota. I haven't lived in Minnesota for all that long. So how about you you sell the North Shore to someone who has never been there? Why is it such a beautiful place to visit?
There is, you remember the hill that we crested just before you get that first peak.
Yeah, and that was in Duluth, right?
Right. And when you hit that part of the highway where you're just about to get your first sight of the lake, it feels like Christmas morning before you walk out to the tree or wherever your presents are. You know, you have that sort of butterflies anticipation, and then you see it. And every time, it's like I'm seeing it for the first time, just the expanse of it, the size of it. It has a beauty and a lure about it, but also sort of a, I'll kick your ass. You're not looking, if you're not watching, I will take you down.
Right, because, you know, where I come from down south, you know, getting on your boat and hanging out at the lake and drinking a few beers or whatever is one thing. But, you know, Lake Superior looks as like you're looking at the ocean.
It might as well be.
It might as well be the northern coast, or they call it the North Shore. So, go ahead.
Well, just briefly, I like the fact that you can have whatever experience you want along the North Shore. You can walk the Superior Hiking Trail and sleep on the ground in a tent and then walk down and stay at a resort with a spa before you head back. So you can have everything from very rustic, bare bones, sort of minimalist experience all the way over to an extravagant resort stay.
And I think we split the difference, didn't we?
Yeah, we were somewhere in the middle. I think it was a nice start to have a fire pit outside. The lake was close, but so
a bed to sleep in
so
indoors.
Yeah, so it was a nice bed and a shower and all that.
Yeah,
so.
And we got a little bit of audio up there, so there will be a North Shore opus of Trilloquy coming up here in a couple weeks. But when we got back from the North Shore yesterday, I was ready to, you know, post pictures to my social media and everything, and I was seeing all over my timeline that Jessye Norman passed away. And before we get too deep into that, I do want to say that today's opus, we're focusing on Meghann Oglesby, one of our own. She works on Performance Today, and, you know, Meghann, it's too bad that I've already had the conversation with Meghann, because I'm sure that she has, you know, some really intense and really poignant things to say about the late, great Jessye Norman, you know, this black woman who rose to classical music fame, not just across the country, but, you know, quite literally around the world. Of course, Jessye Norman is a name you know, but, you know, is there much that you can much you can say about her career and how, you know, it's impacted your career or maybe even your personal listening, your personal
life?
Sure.
Even when I first started as an intern at the first public radio station I worked at, Jessye Norman was the soprano that we played on the air, you know. And okay, so that would have been 1989. And you have to remember that she made a late Met debut. It had only been like 6 years prior.
Right.
She debuted over in Europe
before
she debuted here in the United States. So the sopranos that I remember us playing on the air was Jessye Norman, Kathleen Battle.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, who's the people's diva? I keep remembering.
Are you thinking of Leontine Price?
Well, we would play her too, but
Oh, you're talking about the woman who sang the national anthem at the Super Bowl a few years ago.
Why am I blanking on her name?
Oh, my gosh. This is so embarrassing. Renee Fleming, of
there
course.
We are. Yeah.
Yeah, anyway. And, you know, Renee's story is incredible. You know, you mentioned Kathy Battle. You know, the thing that me and my friends would kiki all the time about is sort of the drama, the tea and the shade between Jessye Norman and Kathleen Battle. And it is there. It is definitely there. Yeah. You know, I remember one interview with Jessye Norman. Now that you've brought up Kathy Battle, she talks about why race is significant and why race is important. And she shaded Kathy Battle a little bit by saying that, you know, it's great to be one of the few black sopranos out in the classical music field, but don't tell Kathy Battle I said that. You know, Jessye Norman always had a sense of humor, such a bright personality, and was always willing to tell her story. And one of the interviews that I watched most recently, you know, as everyone is going back and revisiting the legacy of Jessye Norman, is how she talks about how, you know, she attributes her career to one of the things we talk about all the time on this podcast when it comes to people of color and women. It's access.
Yeah.
You know, she had access to a school arts program, and she had parents. She happened to have parents who were very much involved in, you know, what she did in school, whether it was her math class or English class or her music. And music is, you know, what fueled her career. And I brought in a clip from an interview she did back in 2012 where she speaks to that exact thing.
You know, parents in those days would not have allowed the kind of things that are happening with the school's curriculum these days all over the country and all over the world, that the arts are simply dropping out of the curriculum. They wouldn't have allowed it. They knew how much being a member of the chorus or a member of the movement group or a member of the poetry society or a member of the band, they realized how much this influenced everything else in our lives and that it was a part of education that really is just too important to be left aside.
I absolutely adore listening to her talk. She reminds me of the Oracle from the Matrix.
Yeah.
When, you know, there's a regalness about it, you know, a high educated, you know, sort of proper sort of a sound. But she's talking about things that we talk about right here on the podcast. You know, in an interview from 2014, she talked about how racial barriers are still happening out in the real world. So how can you expect for them not to be happening within classical music and opera? So she was on the forefront of fighting these things, you know, even back in the 80s.
And, you know, a conversation, you know, you mentioned how regal she sounded.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of people might use the phrase well-spoken, and that in itself has become a bit of a pejorative these days.
Mm-hmm.
because with that comes the idea, oh, wow, this black person is a little different. She's actually X, Y, and Z, you know, and, you know, she would even address that in her talks and just in the way she moved by talking about how, you know, you mentioned that she got her start in Europe and not in America. That's because while she was in school, she won this competition in which she got to premiere over in Munich.
I
believe it was, you know.
That makes sense.
So, you know, Jessye Norman is a product of her environment. And despite how buttoned up and stuffed shirt people thought she may have sounded, she was down with the cause, if anybody was, you know, both in her activism and musically. There are so many recordings out there of her singing these beautiful Negro spirituals, just reminding people of her, you know, where she came from, down in Augusta, Georgia. I believe it was Augusta, you know, and the lineage that
she went to Howard. Behind.
She went to Howard, you know, like Jessye Norman was black.
Yeah.
Jessye Norman was black, very much so. And, you know, it's just, you know, I personally look up to her because she was able to traverse all of those different arenas, you know, these age-old European opera houses while bringing her blackness with her. You know, quick shout out to the Need to Know podcast. When I was a guest on their show, what I kept repeating was you can't separate your blackness from your blackness. You know, Jessye Norman was that. Where she landed happened to be classical music, and she happened to be the one of the best to ever do it, you know. But, you know, you cannot take that away from her. And that's the point that I wanted to make here. I'll make the point when I get on the radio later tonight, is that her race is significant because she gave folks like me someone to look to, you know, to say, wow, somebody from the South where I came from, someone who's black like I am, managed to do this thing, you know. And I don't know. There's something to be said about that.
Yeah, climb to the top of something that is, if not considered, at least seen as a white thing.
Right.
And a lot of these roles that she did, she sang all the major roles of Wagner and Strauss, Janacek, Poulenc, all these opera composers that were traditionally sung by European white women. And she came in and gave some of the definitive performances of those operas.
And then in addition to that, you know, like I mentioned, she went into some of these spaces and brought a little black music with her. She did so back in 1990. She sang some Negro spirituals at the Met. And I actually brought in a clip of that performance in particular for us to take a quick listen to as well.
You can have a nation about that. Tell them that Jesus has done. Tell them what the Comforter has come. Any boy, joy, great joy to my soul. Any broad joy, great joy.
Wow, what a legend. Jessye Norman, they were musicians from the Met in that clip from a performance of a Negro spiritual she sang called You Can Tell the World. And wow, yeah, Miss Norman did just that. That performance was led by James Levine, who, you know.
He's canceled.
Yeah.
Well, if not canceled, he's close. He's about to, like, sort of fade away, because I don't know if you've been following the news, but just back in August, the Met settled the suit surrounding his inappropriate behavior, shall we say.
Sure.
It's unknown how much money was actually paid out, but they were seeking almost $6 million.
Oh, my goodness.
So, and you know, he's got it. He's probably got it.
And that's another reason to just, you know, sing the praises of Jessye Norman. You know, there is no telling how much, you know, nonsense and bullshit she had to deal with over in Europe, here in America, you know, for the fact of her being a woman, being a black woman. And, you know, despite all of those challenges, she was still able to make it. So, yeah, rest in power to the now late great Jessye Norman. You know, my favorite, but before we move too far away from her, my favorite performance of hers was her rendition of the El Conish, you know, the Schubert song about a father and son riding home on a horse. We'll listen to it after. We'll listen to it and watch a quick video after we cut off the mics. But, you know, she was even able to, you know, sing these songs and create the example recordings of tunes written for the male voice, you know. So, yeah, such an incredible figure. But it's not, you know, a father and son who we're centering this opus of Trilloquy around, but a mother and child, a mother and daughter, and that mother is Meghann Oglesby. She's a producer on a performance today, you know, if not the most popular classical music radio show, one of the most popular, and she's a producer on that show. And, you know, we had a live Trilloquy event last last week as we're recording this now, and, you know, you wanted to make the point to the crowd that the job of a producer is very important, and Meghann Oglesby is a producer on Performance Today. You're a producer here on Trilloquy, so, you know, why don't you kind of rehash what you wanted to make sure that the audience heard last week, you know, understood about what it means to be a producer, because you know, you have feelings about that and experience in that.
Sure. Obviously, the role of talent is to go out and present the subject matter in the most engaging and, you know, hopefully fun or informative way that you can.
Yeah.
But what you don't see is the mountains of work that goes on leading up to that. Okay, so a producer is putting together all of the nuts and bolts to make sure that the talent can go out there and shine.
Yeah.
Okay, so I mentioned in the Clara Schumann event when interviewing Meghann, I get here in the morning and she's here.
Yeah.
I leave in the evening and she's still sat there. There's times where I've been going on in the air at 7 and she'll walk by me, you know, loaded up, leaving, and she's also doing CrossFit, and she's always got a weekend calendar full of social things that she's doing and taking care of her daughter on top of all of it. I don't know if I got enough gas in the tank to do everything that she does.
Oh, I certainly don't. You know, just we spent a bit of time talking about Jessye Norman. Meghann Oglesby is another one of these phenomenal Black women who is just doing the work to a level that I cannot even understand. You
making
know,
it happen, happen.
You know, she not only does she just make it happen, but she makes it happen, as you mentioned, while having so many other things going on, including, you know, raising her beautiful daughter.
And that's the rub.
Ooh, yep. Goodness gracious, having a child to take care of is something I cannot wrap my mind around. I can't take care of myself a lot of the time, much less me and someone else. So yeah, how about we hop into my conversation with Meghann Oglesby. Meghann Oglesby, thank you so much for coming to this Your Classical Black Employee meeting. I think we all here.
We are all here.
You know, people talk all the time about creating diverse spaces and all that stuff, but, you know, just the fact of having somebody Black to talk to and connect to is just so important to the workplace, in my opinion.
Oh, my gosh. Garrett, before you, I was the only person in the club. So it's really refreshing to be able to come to this special meeting today. And I appreciate you for having me on.
Amen. You know, something I always tell people, you know, when they just want a specific example of why it's so important for, you know, Black folks to have comrades in the workspace. When I was moving here, one of my big concerns was, where in the world am I going to get my hair done?
Oh.
And I remember just seeing you on the email list. And I was like, okay, well, she know. And, you know, the person you suggested to me is who keeps it tight here in the Twin Cities. So I appreciate that.
Very, very happy to be able to help you out in that way.
Yeah. It's just something that so many people take for granted. You know, and we're talking about community in the workspace and otherwise. You know, community, specifically Black community, it seems like has always been something important to you, all the way down to the sorority that you so proudly represent everywhere you go.
Yes. Yes, it has. I mean, I moved to the Twin Cities when I was 16 with my family.
Mm-hmm.
And
from where?
From Chicago.
Okay.
And I, for the first time in my life, was in a space where I was the minority all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I grew up on the south side of Chicago. I went to a really diverse high school. My elementary school was mostly African American children. So I had never really been in schools or other places where most of the time it wasn't a whole lot of people like
right.
me.
Right.
So that was really, really interesting for a 16-year-old. Why did I start talking about that?
We were talking about you moving here and community and finding other, you know, Black people to sort of, you know, cultivate that community, and how community has been an important part of, you know, your upbringing and your journey.
Right.
It's early. It's fine.
It's early. So that that was really an interesting experience for a 16-year-old. So I finished my last 2 years of high school, and I got on out of here, and I went to an HBCU.
Which was what? Which one?
Which was Rust College in Holly Springs, Mississippi.
You went to Rust.
Okay. I sure did.
Yeah, I know other people who went to Rust. And every time I talk to someone who went to an HBCU, I just have to say that, you know, no matter how many episodes of A Different World I watched as a child,
yeah,
the idea of going to an HBCU for some reason just was not presented to me. You know, my parents didn't go to college, so they couldn't really push that forward. What got you to an HBCU? You wanted to see some more of your folks, I guess.
I did, but both of my parents went to Rust College.
Okay, so you're a legacy.
I'm a legacy. I'm a second-generation Rustite.
Yeah.
And so I come by it righteously. Both of my parents went there. My favorite aunt, she went there as well, my father's youngest sister. And so all of my life, all I knew was Rust College, Rust College, Rust College, or HBCUs. And I didn't actually want to go to Rust College at first. I wanted to go someplace else. I was really interested in two other schools. I wanted to go to Hampton in Virginia, or I wanted to go to Tennessee State University.
Okay, come on TSU.
Okay, come on TSU. That's where I wanted to go. And it just didn't work out. And I ended up going to Rust College. But I loved it.
Yeah.
I absolutely loved it. Loved it.
Was there a culture shock for you coming from the South Side of Chicago to Minnesota and then down to Mississippi?
Yes. Yes, to say the least. So I probably had a bigger culture shock coming to the Twin Cities, coming from the South Side of Chicago.
Okay.
I remember my first day of high school, because I ended up going to two different schools. I went to class. My first class was a math class. And, you know, they make you come in and stand up and say, hi, my name is whatever, you know, when you're a new student.
Yeah.
And so I came in and he said, you know, you can go ahead and take a seat. The only seats left in the class were in the back. So I go to the back of the room and I sat down. And then he said, okay, class, we have a new student. And, you know, he asked me to stand up. I was the only black person in the room. And I said hello to everybody and told them, you know, what my name is, and I just moved here from Chicago. And everybody in that classroom turned around and looked at me, and they turned right back around again. Nobody said a word.
And that was just your entrance into this state, into your new home?
Yes.
And I guess that's what they call Minnesota nice, huh?
That's what they call Minnesota nice, baby. I was like, oh, where did I just walk into? What is this?
Well, did you eventually find a sort of community at your high school, or
no,
was it just you?
I transferred to another school, and I mean, but the reason for that was because they redrew the district lines and said that I had to go to a different school. But that was great for me because I was like, oh yes, I got to get out of here.
Yeah.
Because it just wasn't a very friendly place. But what I will say is that today that school is like majority black people or African students.
Yeah,
so it's really, really interesting that I learned that this year. I say, what? Not that lily white place I went to. But I went to a different school, which was a little bit more diverse, and I had a better experience, but I still didn't really make any lasting connections.
Hmm.
When I came back here to the Twin Cities almost 2 years ago now, I didn't know anybody. I had one person who I kind of kept in touch with over the years from high school, but we didn't keep in touch with each other anymore.
Right.
Matter of fact, I just saw her recently and I acted like I didn't even know who she was.
Acting funny.
So we could cut that out. But I just was not able to make any lasting connections with anybody.
No, were you able to make those connections down at Rust College?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, I was. Yes, I was. Most all of my friends now are people who I met when I was in college.
Now, were you down there as a music student or journalism?
No,
or?
I was down there as a journalism student, although I didn't start off that way.
Okay.
I was a political science major for 4 years.
For 4 whole years?
For 4 whole years before I decided to change my major to mass communications.
Oh, okay. So what is something in particular that inspired that?
Yes. So everybody thought I was a mass comm major anyway, because I was always over there in the department doing something. I was just over there hanging out. I was just over there for fun.
Yeah.
I was doing the newscast. I was an anchor. I worked in the radio station.
Mm-hmm.
I had my own radio show. I was on the air every Saturday. I had a R&B show on Saturday nights.
Okay.
And I was just always over there just because. Meanwhile, other students are complaining about doing newscasts. I was over there having a, I was over there doing it for fun. I didn't have to be there. I just signed up. I said, yeah, let's do this. And then I looked up and realized that's where I was spending all of my time.
Yeah.
And I also realized that I didn't want to go to law school, which was the reason why I had chosen political science as a major. I was thinking, oh, I want to go to law school. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, Meghann Oglesby Esquire. Yeah.
That has a good ring to it.
That has a good ring to it. And my dad wanted me to go to law school, and I always enjoyed political science. And I mean, well, not political science. I always enjoyed social studies classes.
Yeah.
I've always noticed that I consistently made the best grades in social studies classes, even over English classes. Mm-hmm. I consistently made the best grades there throughout my educational matriculation. So I was like, okay, this is a logical choice, poli-sci.
Yeah.
But obviously that wasn't where my heart was. And I ultimately decided to change my major, even though it was going to make me have to spend more time in school.
Right. Yeah. It's something how life just works like that, because, you know, I started as an English major.
Oh.
And when I saw that it wasn't a whole bunch of music classes that I had time for in my schedule, that's when I switched over to music education and then eventually music performance. And yes, college has a way of telling you what's up, isn't it?
You
don't
know,
they?
They do. You know, I wanted to go to school for theater.
Okay.
Actually, I wanted to be an actor. I still want to be an actor. And I didn't go to school for that because my parents told me no.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah.
They said, no. If you want to act, you can do that. But you need to go and get your degree in something else. You need to get something
right.
You can fall back on. So I was like, okay, fine. So I'm going to go pick something else. And I did attempt to go to graduate school for theater after I got my after I got my bachelor's degree. I auditioned for this huge organization that does these big auditions for all of the major theater graduate master's program. All of the major theater graduate programs in the country.
You fine.
And it's called the ERTAs. And they were having their auditions in Chicago 1 year. And this was after I had already graduated and got my bachelor's degree.
Right.
I traveled to Chicago and I went. Back to my hometown. And I ended up getting only one interview with one school.
Hmm.
And they ended up not offering me the fellowship. So I had to go back to the drawing board. I'm just like, what am I going to do?
Because, you know, because people see a degree in something like journalism, mass communications as one of those quote unquote safe degrees.
Yeah.
But I'm sure in that moment it didn't feel like you were completely safe.
No, it did not. And so here I am back in Minneapolis kicking around trying to figure out what am I going to do with this degree.
Yeah.
I mean, I was applying for things. I applied for a job right here at Minnesota Public Radio. And I did not get hired.
See?
Nor did I get an interview, but that's okay because God had another plan for me.
Amen.
And I decided to go back and get my master's in broadcast journalism. So I went back down to the South, but I went to Arkansas State University and got my master's there. And
shout out to Jonesboro.
Oh, yeah. Shout out to Jonesboro, Arkansas.
Yeah.
ASU. And people down there.
And you got that degree. Did the path clear up after you got your master's? Did it seem like you had more options?
No.
I'm sure it didn't.
No, it didn't. Well, let me take that back. I'm not going to say that. I didn't get to the place to where I had to find out. And that's because I got offered a position.
Okay.
I got offered a job. The current president of my alma mater, Rust College in Holly Springs, Mississippi, he called me and offered me a job. He said, I have an opening.
At Rust.
And so he actually called me a year into my program. And I said, I really appreciate that, but I'm still working on my master's. So he said, okay, will you finish? I said, all right. And I did. And he called me back.
Oh, wow.
And he said, I have an opening. He said, you should apply for this job. I said, okay, I'm gonna apply for the job because I was getting ready to graduate.
Yeah.
And I hadn't secured anything yet. At the time, I was trying to get into radio. So I was kind of working at a local radio station in Jonesboro. I was working at a one of those Hot 100 stations.
Sure, yeah.
One of those CHR current hits.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to come in at night on the graveyard shift and do a couple of hours of voice tracking.
Oh, wow.
And I go down there and do my thing, talking about what was going on in pop culture and talking about the music we were listening to. But it wasn't going anywhere. And then they told me that they weren't going to be able to pay me anymore.
Oh, so that's when you really...
And I was like, well, where do I go from here? Like, how am I going to grow with you or do anything if you can't even pay me for the couple of hours I do?
Right.
So I ended up having to leave because at the time I was living on my own. I had bills I had to pay. So
right.
I had to work. So I got a waitress job. I was, slanging tables.
And, child, I know that. I know that world.
Paying my bills while I was wrapping up my master's program.
Yeah.
And so I was blessed to get that phone call and say there was an opportunity. And I applied, and the application process went well. Interview process went well. All of my former teachers who became my interviewers.
Yeah.
And eventually my colleagues were all very impressed with the interview. Apparently they were pleased with what I had learned.
Yeah.
In graduate school. And I was able to start my career there, and I was there for 4 years.
So what pulled you from Russ back to this place that you moved to as a teenager that you didn't really love? And
NPR did.
Yeah.
NPR did. I was at a place in my career where I needed a new job. I was tired of, I wanted to get out of academics, and I wanted to pursue what I had been looking for in the first place, which was a job in radio.
Yeah.
So, I started looking, and I wasn't having any luck in the Mid-South area because I wanted to stay down south, and it just wasn't working out. So finally I said, well, I need to branch out. I can't keep looking in the same places. So I started applying for work in the Twin Cities area and in the Chicago area because I'm like, that's where I have family. Let's look there. So I started looking up public radio.
Yeah.
And who had openings in public radio in those two areas? And I applied for everything that looked like I was qualified.
Yeah. Everything that rhymed with
everything
your degree
that
path.
Everything rhymed with my degree path. anything that I know how to do that, I applied for it.
Mm-hmm.
Did I apply for several jobs in the same company and organization? Yes, I did. I was desperate. I didn't care. And it worked out. It worked out. I got offered this amazing position with Performance Today. And when I was applying for the job, and then when I was hired for the position, at the time, I did not really understand yet the opportunity that I had been given.
Yeah.
And I also didn't understand the kind of impact that I was going to be able to have.
Right, right.
And I also didn't understand or realize that I was going to be the only person like me doing what I do, doing this kind of thing in this company anyway.
Yeah. Before we get into that specifically, I'm curious to know, considering the fact that you had applied for a job with the organization before and didn't hear anything back, did you feel a way coming in? I guess, first of all, What's the relationship between the job you applied for and the job you end up getting? Were they similar?
No.
Okay.
The job I applied for years ago was either a news reporter position or a news producer position.
But not a music.
But it was not a music thing. At the time, I was looking at news.
Yeah. So what attracted you to a more music focused job? I mean, do you have a, you know, you talked about having a background in music radio, but do you have a personal background in music?
Well, the music part of the job description had nothing to do with why I was interested in the job.
Okay.
Okay.
That's interesting.
I meant what I said when I applied for everything that I was qualified for.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And when I looked at the job description for this job, when I saw the opening, it lined up with my educational credentials. It also lined up with the work experience that I had. And it also sounded like something that would really give me the opportunity to flex my creative skills and my journalist skills.
Yeah. That's one of the incredible things about public radio is because I have no educational background in media, broadcast, anything, but because I, come from the world of classical music, I can apply that to this job.
Right.
And in the same way that you can apply your very formal background in journalism and broadcast yes. to classical music.
Yes. And so so the music thing was just a bonus. I was happy that it was in music because I love music. I enjoy classical music. So it was a bonus for me, but it wasn't the main thing that made me go like, oh, yeah, I really want to do this. It was just a happy coincidence.
Yeah, yeah.
I have a little bit of background in music. When I was a kid, I did play the clarinet and the piano.
Okay.
But I eventually gave it up as I got older. And I've always sang. I still sing. And I've done quite a bit of musical theater or singing in theater and things like that throughout my college years and in recent years as well. Actually, the last time I was on stage, I was singing, and that was in 2015.
Okay, not too long ago.
Not too long ago. And the only reason why it's been so long at this point is because I've been taking care of my 3-year-old daughter. So.
Yeah, yeah. Shout out to Morgan.
Shout
She's
out
so
to
sweet.
Morgan.
Yeah, we'll talk about Morgan here in a second. A few minutes ago, you talked about something that you didn't know or that you took for granted was the impact, the unique impact you could have in a job like you have now. Talk to me more about that.
In the position that I have, I get to make a lot of decisions about content.
Mm-hmm.
I get to determine what the show looks like and what it sounds like.
So first of all, what's your official position with Performance Today?
My official position with Performance Today is producer.
Okay.
So we have several different kinds of producers. We have a lot of producers.
Yeah.
Let me say that. Performance Today has a lot of producers.
You need them for a daily show. Like
you need
Performance
them for
Today,
a daily
yeah.
show. But I'm the only producer.
Yeah, you said with a capital P.
With a capital P. So we have our senior producer, the amazing Suzanne Schaefer.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have me. And we have two associate producers. And even though their titles are associate producers, they both have very different jobs.
Yeah.
And then we have technical producers and things like that. So I'm the only just plain producer on the show.
Yeah.
So what I do is I choose the majority of the music that people hear on the show, myself and the senior producer, Suzanne. Between the two of us, we make 97% of the choices in terms of what music gets played on the show.
Yeah, yeah.
Every week. So that is the first huge part of the work that I do. But that's big.
That's huge.
That's huge. Because we are determining what kind of music is on the show. So that means we're determining who and what is being represented on the show.
Right. Exactly. And then when you start talking about, that sort of impact as far as who is being represented, you're talking about what we, conversations surrounding classical music, what we consider classical.
Exactly.
And who gets to be a part of that conversation.
Exactly. And because Performance Today is the most listened to, most popular, most well-known classical music radio program in the country, that is a huge deal because people are looking to Performance Today to say, this is classical music.
Yeah.
This is the music of today. This is the classical music that we should be listening to. These are the people who you should know.
Yeah, yeah.
And to be able to be a part of that is amazing. And I just didn't realize at the time of my hiring that that's what I was getting ready to be doing.
Was there a moment for you? Did you sit down one day and say, oh, my goodness, I can make a difference here?
Yes, I did. And that was after I got here and folks started asking me questions and listening to what I had to say and implementing my ideas and suggestions.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God.
You're like, wait, so this is what we're doing.
so this is what we're doing.
Yeah.
And this is what I can do. And it also happened when I went to, you know, some of our features meetings where I was, you know, we're pitching ideas for, you know, who should we talk to or what should we cover? What kind of things should we be doing on the show?
Yeah.
And I'm coming up with ideas and everybody's like, that's fantastic. Let's do that. And we did it.
Yeah.
That's when I realized how much of an impact I could have. And it's been absolutely, absolutely incredible.
What's an example of one of those ideas you had? I mean, is it as simple as just making sure that you're featuring composers or musicians of color on the show?
It could be, and it is sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is on a daily basis in my daily description of what I need to do every day. And when I'm choosing music, that's ongoing.
Which is more than most of the, I don't know, I'm not trying to drag nobody right now. But for that to be on your, you know, docket every day, I mean, that in itself is phenomenal, especially inside of classical music.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's on my docket every day. Every day when I am programming the show, I am thinking about that. And so is my senior producer, Suzanne Schaefer. The both of us are actively thinking about this every day for every hour of the show that we program.
Mm-hmm.
When we look at the show and we break it into 2 hours, and we look at these individual hours and say, okay, I need to fill it with music. When I'm looking for music to fill those hours with, I'm looking for, do I have anybody of color represented in terms of artists who are playing or the composer or the conductor?
Mm-hmm.
Do I have any women? Do I have any composers who are people who we don't hear all the time?
Right.
Do we have any composers who are not dead?
Yeah.
And we're asking ourselves these questions when we're programming because we're trying to make sure we are hitting several of those areas in each hour of the show.
Yeah, yeah.
Every day.
And we sort of take for granted sometimes why that's important. I mean, why is it important for a show like Performance Today to represent such a wide variety of individuals as far as the programming is concerned?
It's important because we want to represent the community that we serve.
Yeah.
The people who listen to the show are not all the same. They don't all look the same. They're not all from the same places. They don't all speak the same languages. They don't all like the same food. So we need to serve those people. Classical music is not just one type of thing either.
Yeah.
It's being played by so many different kinds of people in so many different places. And the show is called Performance Today.
Yeah.
So we need to reflect what's happening in classical music today.
Yeah.
And we cannot accurately or adequately do that if we're playing only the Beethovens and the Shostakovichs and mm-hmm. the Rachmaninoffs. If
right.
we're only doing that because those are the classics and those are the people who pave the way, we're not leaving room for the music to live on, to continue.
Right, right.
You
got to let it breathe. You got to let it grow.
You have to let it breathe. You have to let it grow. And we wouldn't be Performance Today if we did not reflect what's happening in classical music today.
Right, right. Which is us.
Which is us.
I'm wondering if you had any sort of learning curve when you accepted this position, because without that formal classical music training and background, it seems like, you know, having to deal with, you know, learning about these composers and these orchestras might be a little overwhelming for some folks.
You know, it wasn't that overwhelming, or it hasn't been. And I'm learning every day. I learn every day. I'm still learning every day. But I don't know. I think because of the small bit of musical background that I have, and that I come from a very talented family where, you know, music was surrounding me all the time. My grandmother plays the piano.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up playing the piano. My mother is an award-winning singer and actor. My father sings. My grandmother sings. We all sing. And I've always been in the theater. I grew up sitting in the audience of a theater, watching my mother in her rehearsals while I did my homework.
Yeah.
So I literally grew up on a stage. So it's not that foreign to me.
Mm-hmm.
So there were some things, of course, that I had to learn and that I'm still learning, but it wasn't a huge culture shock for me coming in.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm sure for some people it is. I mean, how do you deal with bridging that gap? Through the programming and through programming, that sort of thing.
The way you bridge that gap is you focus on the narrative, on creating stories and telling stories.
Mm.
And we have such an amazing team. Our script writer, associate producer, Kathleen.
Yeah, who's been on the podcast. Yeah, shout out to her.
Who has been on the show. Shout out to Kathleen. She's incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible in her writing and her storytelling. And she's able to tell stories in such a way that they can reach everybody where they are. And our host, Fred, is amazing, 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 amazing. And the two of them are a dynamic duo. And when they get together to come up with how we talk about these musical choices that myself and Suzanne Schaefer have chosen, they create stories and narratives that tug on your heartstrings and speak to you as a human being. So it doesn't matter what you know or what you don't know. We're telling stories in such a way that should say to everyone that this music is for you.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I'm still listening back to what you're saying has reminded me. I'm still listening back to the newest Beyonce album. And one of the opening tracks is called Bigger, when she's talking about how, you know, everything we do, we have to think about how that applies to the bigger picture. And I think about that, you know, hearing you talk about getting these stories and narratives out there. But it also makes me think about her relationship with her daughter, Blue, and uh-huh. your relationship with your daughter, Morgan. You know, how you know, not only are you touching into the bigger picture as far as classical music, you know, your purpose as a human being is bigger because of her. Right. I mean, how does your job at Performance today parlay with your relationship with Morgan? I'm sure you read a story or hear a piece of music all the time that makes you think about her or think about something dealing with your relationship with Morgan.
Well, the way that it kind of correlates for me is that in the work that I do every day, I already talked about the opportunity that I have to be able to make such a huge impact.
Yeah.
But I get to be able to make an impact in a way that I can help to ensure that people who look like me and people who look like Morgan are uplifted.
Mm-hmm.
I can ensure that their names are spoken. I can ensure that their work is known and is heard. And that gives me and my life more purpose and more meaning, because being able to do that allows me to do something that I know that my daughter can be proud of.
Mm-hmm. You're making my eyes swell up right now.
You know, I get to do something every day that shows people, I get to do something every day that will one day show my daughter that people who are just like her have done these amazing things.
Yeah.
And so that's how I think about it. That's how I think about her and think about what I do. Also, I've always endeavored to do something with my life that's pleasing to God.
Mm-hmm.
And that is going to make my family proud of me. And I get to do that every day with Performance Today.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. And of course, you know, Morgan will grow up to be proud of you. Your parents are proud of you. I'm sure the whole team here is just it's incredible the opportunity that we both have to really not only just demystify this thing called classical music, but make it a space that we all have equal ownership of. Not just a space that we're all invited to, but one that belongs to us equally.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, Meghann, how can, for folks who don't know, how can they check out your work, listen to Performance Today, or learn more about you personally?
Well, you can learn more about Performance Today on our website. That's yourclassical.org/performancetoday. You can listen to any of our shows from the past 30 days there. You can also go back and look at features that we've done. A lot of work that I did on Black History Month for the past 2 years is also there on our page.
As well as Black Music History Month.
As well as Black Music History Month. I created a series for that called the My Name Is series. And that work is there. People can check that out if they're interested in wanting to learn more about the amazing, amazing artists that we have working in classical music right now today, writing music and creating music. Wonderful stories about them. You can hear those stories in their own words, them telling you who they are themselves. That was an amazing project that I had a wonderful time working on last year and this year. That work is there. And I'm on Instagram. My personal page is on Instagram.
We can all take a look at your body transformation.
You are just working out. I am always working out.
It's amazing that you can still, you know, manage to do everything you do as a mother. My hat goes off to you.
Thank you. It's a struggle every day. It's a struggle every day.
But a struggle well worth it, I'm sure.
Well worth it, absolutely. You know, I'm on the ketogenic diet. I've started that in January. My daughter is also on the ketogenic diet because she has epilepsy.
Mm-hmm.
And the diet is just doing wonders for her. She's not having nearly as many seizures as she used to have since she started the diet. I've lost at this point. Last time I checked, I've lost 58 pounds.
Ooh.
And God is good, man. You know, I'm on this, you know, health journey, or I'm just on this journey to be the best me that I have ever been, the best me that I could ever be. Also for my daughter, because she's doing this, I wanted to do it with her. But I also need to be the best me that I can for her, man.
Yeah.
You know, my daughter, because of her condition, she doesn't walk. She has something called CDKL5 disorder, which is a genetic disorder that causes epilepsy, among other things.
Yeah.
It's a very, very, very rare disorder. A lot of people don't know about it. But it is becoming much more, it's becoming more well-known because they're finding out more and more people who have it or who have had it and were never diagnosed.
So awareness is growing.
Awareness is growing. And but because of her disorder, she doesn't walk, she doesn't talk, she's not independent, she can't do anything for herself. And she's 3, she's getting ready to be 4, so that means that she's getting bigger and heavier.
and you got to be able to catch up, keep up.
Mommy has to be able to continue to pick her up and carry her around and, you know, take care of her and all of those things. So, you know, I had to get myself together, if only for that reason.
Yeah.
You know, so it's been a wonderful journey. I don't know how I'm doing it, but
but you're doing it.
But I'm doing it. I'm doing it the best way I can.
Well, thanks again for sitting with me, and thanks. You know, we started out talking about my hairstylist. Shout out to Jenny. Every time I sit in that chair, I thank you.
Oh,
for hooking me up. So
you're welcome. Like, I remember when I got the email, because every time somebody gets hired in a company, they send an email out to everybody saying, hey, we have a new employee coming in. Make sure you welcome them. And I got that email saying that you were going to be here. I was like, oh, I emailed you right away. Like, I think you were still in Nashville. I was just like, welcome to the team. So looking forward to meeting you.
Yeah, yeah.
So happy to have you.
to creating and maintaining community.
Yes. Very, very important, because I know what it's like to come to Minnesota as a Black person.
Yeah.
And feel alone. And I just didn't want that to happen to you. So I was like, let me try to make a friend.
Well, hopefully by the time we sit down again, the your classical Black employee meeting will be expanded beyond just the two of us.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thanks
yes.
again, Meghann.
Thank you.
I am really glad that you had that experience with her as well, moving here. You know, which she says, moving as a Black person, let me help you out. Because as a white person, I didn't get any help when I moved here. I didn't know where I was going.
Well, your hair isn't as, how can I say this politely? It doesn't require the upkeep that mine does. I have a little more of it as well.
maybe not, but I will tell you that as a man who wears a beard year round, I don't let anybody touch this.
Yeah, yeah. And I can tell. It looks very good.
Thanks, man. I love Meghann. I just have to go on and say that she is such a positive vibe to have around.
Listening back to our conversation, you know, it warms my heart. And I think on the last Opus of Trilloquy, you know, we were talking a little bit about, you know, getting into those rough spaces where, you know, you're trying to, you know, reaffirm your purpose, whether mm-hmm. it's at your job or even on this earth. And, you know, hearing Meghann really affirm her purpose in so many different ways, but how they come together is just so beautiful. Because, you know, let's take her job alone. Again, Performance Today is such an important show in the classical music ether. You know, she's the producer of that, you know, so that in itself is high purpose. But then for her to see an even higher purpose in that, creating something and maintaining something that her daughter Morgan can grow up and listen to and see and be proud of her mother, to say, you know, my mom did that. It's so beautiful. Shout out to Meghann Oglesby. Be sure to listen to her work on Performance Today. Again, you can catch that at yourclassical.org/performance today. Scott, my first big national radio break was on Performance Today. So it's a...
Now look at you.
It's a... yeah, look at me now. I have a lot of respect for that show. You know, as we close up here, I just wanted to reprise one thing that Meghann said. You know, she made the point that in her position, not only does she, you know, choose the music that you hear, but you choose who and what is represented through that music. And, you know, I was very honored to have the opportunity to not just guest host an episode. I've guest hosted several at this point, but, you know, that first one, I didn't just get to guest host it. I got to bring my perspective, and they even let me program the music, which of course would include a bit of Blackness,
That's
you know.
Key.
Knowing me. So yeah, shout out to Meghann, shout out to the whole team, shout out to Kathleen Bradbury, who we had on Trilloquy a while
Opus
ago.
Four.
Yeah, wow. So another important member of the Performance Today team. Hope that we'll get to collaborate with them again soon.
And what are we looking for next time on Trilloquy? Very special Opus.
Yeah, the very first live Opus of Trilloquy. So we were invited by American Public Media to record Trilloquy in front of some of our donors. And we explored Clara Schumann in honor of her 200th birth anniversary. We explored her as a musician, as a muse, and as a mother. So on the next Opus of Trilloquy, you'll actually get to hear from Meghann again for a bit. We also speak to a couple local musicians and the newest member of our team here on C24, Melissa Dundas. So be sure to tune in next time for the very first live Opus of Trilloquy.
And remember, if you want to reach out, you can. Just send an email to trilloquy@americanpublicmedia.org. That's TRILLOQUY @americanpublicmedia.org.